It caters to, you know, to poverty. My name. Okay. Here used to stand a supermarket owned by Filipinos or run by Koreans, you know, whichever one. It was hit, you know, by the riot, and I mean, basically. You can just look at it and tell that.
Was there anybody hurt or was anybody killed in there?
Well, I wasn't in this area during the time of the riot. I was over on the west side of town in the jungles. It's my ex-neighborhood. I recently moved over here. But I lived down in this area once before and nothing's really changed. You know, there's still drugs, still gangs. Fire there, you know, and it was kind of hard because, I mean, the people in different buildings and merchants.
So how come they were taking out their frustrations on Koreans? Why the Koreans?
I believe the frustration that was took out on the Koreans has a lot to do with Keisha Harlan.
Is that the black woman that was shot in the back by the Korean woman over the counter?
That's why the frustration towards the Koreans occurred during the riot.
I have one more question. Is there a black community leader?
Yes.
Do you have someone, an African American, who leads the youth, gives direction?
I'll say the biggest community leader is the drug dealer that turned other youngsters on to making quick money, or you know, the big time gangster that everybody is scared of and they have no choice to flee. That's the community leader over in this neighborhood. We have no one on a positive level to really step in and say, you know, let's get out there, march or pick it or do whatever we have to do to maintain, you know, a positive stride, you know what I'm saying? We basically got a lot of negativity, which I feel needs to be, you know, ridded from the neighborhood. It's like the name,
when I was younger in the army, it was kind of different. They were different. They were always did what they needed to do. They were conscientious objectors. Like when I used to them, I was in a directional facility in that Kansas.
Tim, you being a Muslim, tell me how you feel that the Muslim philosophy has made a difference to you and how what your understanding is about being a young man, how to stay away from all the influences that are bad. What has the Muslim done for you to how do you maintain?
Well, you know, I started off in the Nation of Islam at a very young age. I was like maybe like 9 or 10. My Uncle Muhammad back in Atlanta, Georgia. And at a young age, I learned that there is, you know, unity within blacks through the Nation of Islam. And, you know, as I got older and progressed within the religion, you know, I got to, you know, understand and learn more about cultures. It's not that, you know, it's not more of a traditional thing how most youngsters they grow up in whatever religion their parents are,
yeah.
they become. It was more of a decision that I made myself.
So you went to the do that, let's say the mayor couldn't do, or the school, the high schools couldn't do for you, or teachers in the schools, or your friends, or just around the blocks couldn't tell you or do for you. What were the Muslims, did you feel they were going to do?
Yeah, I feel that the Muslims, you know, put one foot towards unity
yeah.
in the black race, you know, and like nowadays. The Nation of Islam has so much controversy. I mean, it's like, you know, it's pitiful because we have militant Muslims, we have humble Muslims, and then we have scientific Muslims. And I'm more or less the Muslim that philosophizes, so I'm on the scientific tip. It's like, I look at the situations around me, and I mean, I just basically come up with a philosophy myself. Nobody out here saying, okay, this is why this happened, or this is why I feel this is what happened. It's like basically, I mean, I learned through the Nation of Islam to really reach within myself. How you was telling me earlier that you seen how the Muslims was more independent, and you know, they was like deep, and they, you know, really dug within themselves to be that way. And that's, you know, that's what I got from the Nation of Islam. You know, I got the ability to reach within myself and basically understand things to the best of my ability before I go out and search for someone else to understand. Okay, as you can see in the background, a lot of Thrifty, Payless, who are the national brands, was burned down during the riot. Now, I really don't see the purpose of the burning, but I know the purpose of the burning. It's like, what you do, you go in, you loot the store, and you just burn the store down to cover up any tracks of fingerprints. And it's like, most people don't think that the looters was thinking like that. But, I mean, you know, most of my friends was out here doing it, and some of my family was out here doing it, and I know why.
Let me ask you, people in the Salt Lake City, which is 99.9% white people, they see the burning out here and they see the kids doing that. They're saying, why are you burning up your own neighborhood? What's your answer to why would African Americans come into this neighborhood in their own neighborhood and torch them? Why not Rodeo Drive?
Like I say, the burning, I feel, came from like a low mentality and immatureness, because I mean, they ran in and took the goods. It wasn't that like they got together and said, okay, let's burn.
Yeah.
You know, just basically one individual, you know, from the spirit of the moment, the excitement, you know, had his lighter or his gasoline or whatever, and just set a fire. And then once the fires were set, it spread like a trend. I mean, everywhere else, every other place they looted, it was like, okay, we burnt it down over here, you know, just fuck it, like burn it all down, you know, and that's basically how it went. It didn't, you know, it wasn't a plan like you go in,
oh, I said,
take it out and burn it. And it's like, okay, everybody's
kind of like
out.
A happening.
Yeah, just like, you know, what's happening.
Well, so then there's the other questions are, they say that the African Americans are out here in the far reach areas of Los Angeles, and you can't trust them. These are a lot of people, let's say they're on this side of the poverty line. They're like over here, they're making money, they're middle class and above. They got all this stuff going for them. They're sitting back there saying, well, you got African Americans out there in South Central LA. You got them out there in Crenshaw. You got them out there in Watts. And we can't do nothing for them. For one, we can't trust them. One, they won't listen. For two, they won't listen. We got youth. You send them to school, they're not going to go. All they're going to do is get an opportunity. And they're going to burn stuff. No matter what nobody tells them, you can't do nothing with them. What do you say to that?
Well, basically, I mean, the environment speaks for itself. I mean, you can look around now and see that this ain't no place that you would really want to live. I mean, and when it comes down to trusting you know, the youth or the black people over in South Central LA. I mean, you can't trust nobody that you don't know. That's what I feel. And I mean, you can't, the problem, it won't get bigger and it won't get smaller. It'll just stay, you know what I'm saying? And it's feeding for a direction to go. Because right now the problem is confused because we got so many people saying that, okay, this is what we want to do. We want to stop paying this. We want to stop the graffiti on the buses. We want to stop the drug problem. But that's just words. You know what I'm saying? We don't have nobody like really coming out here.
So what's one thing that you think in this community that would stop things like rioting from happening? What thing would get African Americans, youth, you know, believing and wanting to be a part of America and wanting to be a part of its success? What thing that you can think of that would change things around? Or several things, just some idea.
All right, for one, I feel that the riot was just totally blown out of proportion. It was like the people that participated in the riot jumped on the bandwagon was the Watts riot, because the riot was started in Watts because of physical abuse.
Okay, Rodney King.
No, in Watts, the Watts riot.
Oh, from back in the 60s? Or?
Yeah.
Okay, yeah.
But this riot was started on a more like political, you know, type situation. We should have handled it in, you know, in the courtrooms.
You mean like they didn't give justice to Rodney King?
Yeah. And we should have handled it that way with the papers, the signatures, the standouts, the marches, or whatever, you know what I'm saying? We did it when King was here. And like I say, you know, when Martin Luther King came about, I mean, we had so much spirit, we wanted to do it. Now we have no King and no Malcolm, all the motivation is gone. Which I feel, instead of burning down everything, that should have inspired that motivation to get out here and say, you know, we ain't getting no justice burning our neighborhood down. You know what I'm saying? And now I know for a fact, a lot of people realize that now because you have no thrifties to go get no ice cream, no, pay less shoe stores for the, you know, low-income family. And I mean, I feel that the riot situation was just a lot of immature people jumping on the bandwagon out there to get something free. Now I'm not going to cover up for them because I'm black or I'm from this community, but that's how I feel. Prevent this type of situation again is if we get somebody really strong, not just one somebody, but you know, a group of people. Like I realize, I mean, it starts with the individual, but if you can get a certain motivation, it don't have to be a certain person, it could be a certain song or a certain way of life, you know what I'm saying? But what we need is that type of motivation. You need a motivation that will, you know, wake us up, make us more aware and motivated instead of frustrated to come out and do stuff like this.
No, there's one damn is that how desolate and empty the ghettos are and how there's no hope. You think you can show us that? You think you could go to places where you can show us how desolate it is here for some people? Also part of the street story that we're going to tell. He's going to tell us a little bit about why. You know, why the division of races? Why?
I don't know.
What kind of problem?
But look here, the system helps create a lot of problems. Even before the thing was passed down, they say whatever it may be, let's all remain calm. So, the system itself helps create the problem. I know, like you know, that the president of America says it's the most inhumane thing he ever saw in his life. And for jurors to go in and find him not guilty, you know,
it was unbelievable how they were, I know.
Unbelievable. Yeah. He says it's the worst situation of inhumane he ever saw in his life. And they go in and find him not guilty.
What do they say, they're like, for instance, that the black people have all the justice that anybody can possibly give?
We don't have any justice. Let's face it. We had a route 1965 to this day here now. Hell, and behind these routes, the rich get rich and the poor get poor. Now, I'm going to tell you what I mean. This man that owned this liquor store here, the people in the Gold Connection, they took all the money and everything out, took it home with them. And say, let them have them peanuts, liquors, and shit. And they got paid off from insurances, $500,000, whatever the insurance was. So you understand what I'm saying? The rich get rich. Got a lot of liquor, drank 3 or 4 days when it was over. We are back in the same situation. Back in the same. Same people living in these alleys, they're still living here today. And to think that we have an injustice, we don't have any injustice.
So what could change things? What one thing you think would happen that would just change things around? Jesse Jackson coming through here?
Hell no. Jesse Jackson coming through here wouldn't change. And they make the talk and come down here with all the security and they leave. And the next 2 or 3 days, we right back to the situation.
Well, you got $1 billion. The president's going to give $1 billion. Spread it around. And
he's going to give $1 billion from what? The city of L.A. right now say they have no money. Paying the teachers with IOUs. He's gonna give $1 billion into people that have money. And hell, if you've been 56 years, I believe, and it's hard for me to think that I'm about to expire, the black man is no further along today than he was years ago. He has less. The jails are full. What the hell good is a jail if you take a man that's 18 years old and keep him in jail 10 years and when he come out he got no skills, so he comes right back to doing what he was doing before he went in.
You meant Tim, haven't you? Yeah. I understand what you said.
Yeah.
You meant Tim.
Yeah.
Let me ask you this question now. What would you, as a older African American, say to Tim, younger African American, about what you see? What does it mean to you?
Well, it's hard to say anything to them. I say this, we need to change the whole penal system. If we take a guy that's 18 and for whatever he's done and keep him in prison for 5 years and send him back out with no trade, we send him back out to do the same damn thing that got him there.
What about being young and wondering about, you know, the future that they may have? When what you know of and what you saw, what can you look back and say what may be good for him?
Very hard to say. It looks real bleak for black.
Black youth? You agree with that, Tim?
I agree. I mean, I'm serious as all hell. To think that I was here doing a 65 riot, trying to protect my family, but we come right back now and we have this riot, and this is that. And ain't no damn situations change.
Like I was saying earlier.
Ain't no damn situations change.
You blame it on white people?
I don't blame it so much on white people, I blame it on the system. Now, you got a lot of black people that's a part of that system. I mean, talking about puppet blacks. We as black people now, we ain't got no damn black leaders. We don't have no Malcolm X, we don't have Martin Luther King or whatever.
That's what you were saying earlier.
Exactly. Right? If we got some progressive black leaders, tell them to me. I don't mean the kind we can sell out. Yeah, we not much further along now than we were in the 60s. See the Rodney King thing right on video that was showed all over the world, and we go in and find three guys that the world knows is guilty as hell, find them not guilty. It's more than I understand. And I wonder will there ever be any justice for the black man.
And I feel, a lot of situations people feel are kind of scared to touch on. I mean, my opinion, I would like the world, Salt Lake City, the UK, Japan, or whatever, to just turn the situation around. Put Rodney King as a white man in the three officers as black. But the same videotape, same blows, the same tasers, the same kicks, the same stumps. Then do you think that the three black men would have got off?
No.
Oh, no.
The worst situation I ever saw in my life.
Oh yeah, come on.
Oh,
They're going to talk a little bit about the ride, like what went on. From my understanding, it started right around here. There's a lot of people out there that are saying that African American youth just want to laugh. They're looking for a reason to go to the streets so they can make some changes. It wasn't about Rodney King.
No, I'm gonna tell you now.
It's like this. We're tired, you know, of the blacks, the young blacks, you know, getting so messed around in the community, you know, they don't want us to work, you know. They feel that we, you know, ain't good enough to work for them because the neighborhoods we come from, because the people we run with, you know, they ain't giving us no chance, you know, they ain't looking at our point of view.
They ain't making no job opportunities.
Nah, they ain't making no jobs or nothing. So when the brother goes out here and, you know, striving, put his hustle down to make his money, you know, the others, they look at us as, you know, that's what we are, you know, just gangsters out there wanna sell dope, wanna ride and kill. You know, but if they give us some, you know, to look toward, you know, like a child born, you know, where we can make more money like that, then it will go out like that. Rodney King, man, that theory, that's just one of the things that just broke some backbone, you know.
Let me ask you this. Now they say there's a big difference. They assume there's a big difference between white kids on the east side, living here, got them BMWs and going to school, than the kids who are down on this side. What's the difference?
First of all, the income and the standard of living is much different. You know, it's like, if my parents were working, both my parents were together, you know, and one was a doctor and a lawyer, it's not the Cosby Show, you know what I'm saying? But for the other people in the other urban areas, you know, who have a high standard of living, it's like, life is easy for them. You know, they can go to school, they can drive to school, they don't have to worry about getting robbed, you know, they don't have to worry about getting shot when they walk the streets, you know, they can do what they want to do at 8 hours. They don't have to worry about how to dress when they go places, you know, but when they come here, it's totally different.
So what would you tell them? You know, I mean, you know, like, they out there, they kicking back, they're not related. So what would you tell them?
That's their choice, not related, opposed to ours, what's really going on. And that's why all of this happened, the tour of the team, that was detrimental for our community. We saw about the liquor stores and gas stations, we were tired of the booty hands. Telling us that they don't want to pay us to sweep floors or anything. They don't want to give us 2 cents back to the community. You know what I'm saying? It's like, what can you do about that? We can't just buy them out with no money. It's easy for them to come here and to walk into a bank and get a business loan, but it's so hard for us, and we've been all our lives, to walk into a bank and get a business loan. You know?
Yeah.
It's because like we smell different, you know? What's the difference? You know, if we all supposed to be treated with these laws, you give them the same consideration.
You think are we all just people?
We're
people of different cultures.
But it's like, I don't know. I feel like us as blacks, I made an effort to explore different cultures. And we try to keep things spread out. Whereas other people of other races, they try to keep a tight end on that culture, that people don't want to share. So anytime you go someplace and all you see is like Chinese writing, something like that, you got a street sign. It's like, come on, look at that. You know, everybody. Everybody's talking about having something black on, but I'm not seeing anything yet. You know, it's like, if we tore it all up, we could buy something back.
But see, all black people should come together instead of like black people like in gangs, they're just killing up people like us, and then like the white people, they living rich. But see, they ain't gotta worry about getting robbed every time when they walk up and down the street. Like, it seems like black people, they get sweated all the time because it's like gang stuff and they ain't right. Like, all black people should just come together.
Instead of
like all this graffiti and stuff on the wall.
Check it out. That's right, but since like this is, it's called the system. Everything is popping in the system. We the black folks go through the lowest system there is. You know what I'm saying? We go to jail for nothing most of the time. 9 out of 10 times, most black people get arrested for nothing. At the time, 10, 20 years ago, finally you innocent. You see what I'm saying? We get treated like we the lowest thing on earth, but we're still not. We do make more than everybody else is. And I feel, as my said, when the system treats you bad, you gotta learn to beat the system. You know what I'm saying? You go with the system, you're gonna lose every time. That's why this ride, all this stuff is the system. You know what I'm saying? If the white man got beat up like that, he can get paid. When it comes to a brother or any nation that ain't white, it don't happen like that. 9 out of 10 people you see black get arrested, beat up by the police, you never hear about it. You know what I'm saying? They rap right, you never throw right in the trash. You may report, but we don't know where the report is. You know, 6, 7 months later, you know, get beat up again by it. You know, you say, why has it been a police officer? They're the most crooked motherfuckers on earth. If they're not crooked, how do the system get caught up in his own system? White man bring the dope over here, we can't catch him, but we bust 14 guys in with 23 keys, all black. But how did he get in? We don't know, we asked a black guy. You see what I'm saying?
I see exactly.
But it's all about the system, it's all about money. If black people come together and they become as one, we can take over anything.
See, what I think what they trying to hide, you know what I'm saying, is like, when they talk about, you know, just completely cut out gangbanging. You know what I'm saying?
It's like,
not a gangster. I'm not a, you know, gangster. You know, I'm Muslim, you know. But I feel when they say stop gangbanging, that would be stopping unity, because even though it's different sets and hoods are at, you know, at their beef, but I mean, if they say totally squash it, that would be squashing the unity of whatever set he from. You know what I'm saying? I bet you it's more unity within his set, within his hood, that it is with them blacks of the corporate black America. You know what I'm saying? The blacks of the black corporate America.
They are trained to make money for the white corporate America.
That, and then they also trying to maneuver past each other. But I bet you every last one of these brothers, when it's his time to go, his boys will be down here with him. It's time to go. We need to keep that kind of thinking. But what we gotta do is just, once we link,
make a positive move. Yeah, if we just step up, we can boost our stuff up, you know, be rich like everybody else. Maybe now you're going to be 4 and 5 later on the world. But they want to keep that number real low. If everybody became millionaire, you know what I'm saying, won't be no power. Nobody can take over. Nobody can't tell what people to do. You need the money up there where only the white can have control of. They always going to tell the poor people what to do. You don't go by our rules. We can just start tearing up their motherfucking shit. Burning that shit up, destroying their shit. It's a whole different. We want them motherfuckers dead. Nah, we come to get you, you gon' die. They're like, why did he die? We don't know. You know what I'm saying?
Like, what's real important?
No, and I mean, I'm not safe around here. We going to the store, somebody just turn around the corner and just start shooting at you. She free.